This is a meeting of the Public Works Commission, City of Northampton, Wednesday, September 9th, 5:30 p.m. This meeting is being recorded by Northampton Community Television. First on our agenda is public comments. Are you here to make public comment or an item on our agenda?
Comment.
Okay.
Jay Binsky, 110 Jackson Street. I just have a quick, probably stupid comment.
Jay what?
Binsky.
Binsky?
B.
Tree committee.
Formerly. About the proliferation of double yellow lines on residential streets, I noticed, just driving home, now Massasoit has a double yellow line. It's kind of changed the character of that from a neighborhood type street to more of a thoroughfare. Feels like a Route 9. The same thing kind of happened with Prospect Ave and now Woodlawn. So it just, I think it says to drivers, you know, this is a major street, go fast, discourages people from on-street parking now because they feel like they're blocking the lanes. So it's kind of, I think, destroying some of the character of our residential streets. So I'd just like to see the city think about the policy of striping some of these residential streets in such a way. That's all I have to say.
Are we following any particular guidelines?
We were looking at it as a traffic calming part also, trying to keep cars in their own lanes and narrow the roadway a little bit.
Okay.
Didn't realize it would be offensive to neighborhoods.
Sure.
No, I think it just visually it feels a lot, doesn't feel like a neighborhood street anymore. That's just my opinion.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming in. You're welcome to stay for the whole meeting.
As much as I like.
Yeah, as much as I like. Thank you.
Jay.
Yes.
This is a surprise.
Well, I know. I didn't know you needed me for quorum, so I can stay till 6.
Oh.
Maybe we
I
might be
you
done.
I thought you were going to be
here. I wasn't?
Oh. I thought
it's. He just said he didn't have anything to add to the agenda.
Yeah.
No.
Now you're going to work.
Am I here?
But you didn't know what meeting you were at because you wanted to know what the agenda was.
Yeah, I'm here.
Next on the agenda. Our minutes for approval. We have the July 15th Public Works Commission meeting, which is the one at JFK to deal with the water system study.
Moved approval.
Second.
I provided a couple of edits late this afternoon.
Because you received them late this afternoon.
Any other comments? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes. And now we have the minutes of the August 19th Public Works Commission meeting.
Move approval.
Second.
I provided a few minor edits on those also.
Yeah.
Any other comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes.
Abstaining.
Rose is abstained. No new business. Under old business, discussion of our strategy for preparation of the CWMP presentation. And I noticed Ned has provided, he provided an electronic copy of the presentation to us. And
well, I don't have one for MJ because
okay.
She's going to make it here.
Hard copy in front of us.
So I got my own.
So as you recall, we met a number of weeks ago and had a presentation from Kleinfelder here and with a number of comments that you had. Last Wednesday, I got together with Kleinfelder for the afternoon, and we went through the slides, your comments, and changed things around a bit as far as slide presentation. I think it reads or follows a lot better now, but I'm not sure it's exactly what you also want to show to be presented also. So I'm not sure if you had a chance, time in advance to look at this, or do you want to go through it slide by slide tonight, or do you want to just give me your comments in the next day or so? I'm not sure how you want to do this.
I went through and I have a number of comments, so I don't know.
I do as
does
well.
The commission want to go through the presentation?
How do you think?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Let's do that. I would like to start by saying there were sections that I thought provided detail that I'm not sure belongs in the presentation.
Okay.
If, from my perspective, I'm not sure the public needs that level of detail. So you're going to hear that a couple of times as we go
okay.
through here.
I have some comments
here.
Similar to that, so
okay.
We might find some consensus.
All right. Good.
Slide one, slide two.
All good.
Page two, top slide. Page two, bottom slide. What was removed from that bottom slide was the future wastewater flows and loadings. And we took that whole section out of the presentation. If I recall right, you wanted the presentation to be about the now, not the future.
Right. So, slide four, which is the bottom of page two, seems to be a slide that says, this is what we're going to talk about, and then we proceed to talk about it. And then we go through it in the presentation. Mm-hmm. It's my experience, often when, sometimes you get hung up spending too much time telling them what you're going to talk about, and then you tell it to them all over again.
Okay.
And I know there's this theory about you tell people what you're going to tell them, and then tell them what you told them. But sometimes that just takes too much time. So I saw that slide as being optional, but
okay.
It's up to others too.
Or is this a 5-second slide so they know what we're going to flow into?
If the presenter can, who's the presenter? You or the?
It'll be Kleinfeld.
If they can discipline themselves to do it that way,
okay.
Then I think that works. It's if they find themselves feeling that they need to explain what these words mean, then it drags out a little bit.
I totally agree with you. I didn't have the same comment on that. But my other thought is that this will probably go on the website. And so sometimes, even if we can discipline the army, mm-hmm. they can discipline themselves to go through it, but it's on the website that's a balance.
That's a good consideration. I didn't. That might reflect some of my comments. Okay.
But we don't want the presentation to go so long that people are falling asleep or leaving.
Well,
so
and
that's a good point.
And we need them to leave understanding the most important piece,
right.
Which is the treatment by phone.
Right.
Okay.
Top of page three, just an introduction. Bottom page three, we removed some of this information about the leachate pump station. There's a comment here about trying to make it into layman's terms. There's enough sewer pipe to go all the way to Boston. And I was kind of looking at it, and I said, yeah, I think people know about 110, they know it's a trip to Boston. So I didn't do anything with that. There's also a slide that was in here that we took out and put on the next page, page four, which was the wastewater collection system development and the sewer spine materials. They became new slides, and they were pulled out of that particular slide previously. On page five at the top, one thing that changed was condition not evaluated was the city performing its own inspections. That wasn't done as part of this study.
Well, I'm sorry, Ned. Top of four?
Top of four and bottom of four were from the old presentation. It was pulled out of the slide and made two separate slides.
Sure. The purpose of the top slide is, I guess it goes without saying that the basic trunk system, the spine system, is more important.
Well, it shows the creation of the system over the years, starting off in the 1800s. Basically, as the city developed, and a lot of it actually, I think, was federal funds that came through in the 70s that really pushed the interceptor lines.
And we're showing this because we don't have similar data for all the pipes in the city?
I don't think that information is there. They collected information on the spine, the interceptor parts, and not all the little side streets.
The spine was what they used for the model, I think, right?
Right, it was.
Okay.
That's when they're doing the hydraulic capacity, they looked at the spines of it. And then existing conditions just showed people that wow, we've got a lot of AC pipe in the ground out there. Do we have a future liability? I mean, I'd love to get rid of the vitrified clay also. But, so just a kind of general information of what's out there. Top of page five, we pulled out, actually we added information in here. Under the pump station, we added about the years of service of the pump station that was in there prior. Prior, it was just fairly good and concerned with alarms and telemetry. We wanted some actual numbers in there that four of these pump stations are greater than 37 years old and two are greater than 25 years old. Nothing changed on the manhole condition, and the only thing that was added on pipe age and condition was the condition not evaluated, which because we perform our own sewer camera inspections. The next slide down, bottom of page 5, was not changed at all.
What's PS failure?
Pardon me?
PS failure?
Pump station. And then we continue to talk about the added new slide, which was the CMUM requirements. Well, actually, now we put the guidelines that we know they're going to be in our new permit.
This is one where I thought it was too much.
Okay.
It doesn't, I don't think it contributes much to the overall message that we're trying to deliver.
Okay.
And I also, it's distracting to see that apparently there's some things that we do and some things that we don't do.
Okay.
And I don't know. I don't want people to get distracted by that message, is
okay.
What I was thinking.
So what changed in the next slide, bottom of 6, was that the old slide went right into existing conditions of wastewater treatment, which has been pushed further back in this new presentation now. So we continued on with on-site wastewater needs analysis, which was basically looking at it's poor soil conditions, septic system failures, things of that nature. And on page 7, there's two of those slides that discuss that, the on-site disposal needs, such as we did in Laurel Park and a few other areas of the city, and the methodology that was used to evaluate it.
What, can I ask a question?
Sure.
How is the relevance to the core question, which is how do we get the money to fix the plant? And this is a total sidetrack, in my opinion.
It's part of this comprehensive plan that we've done. It was actually a task of the plan. And that's why it's in here as a discussion point. If we don't want to discuss off-site disposal, or on-site disposal, excuse me, we can eliminate this section. If you really, truly just want to do plant and collection system.
We should discuss it, because I had a similar reaction that I was wondering if we could get by with just presenting the map, saying we looked at the unsewered areas of the city and we've identified some high priority areas, but they don't fit into our near-term capital improvements program.
Right.
And then move on.
Yeah, I think it makes sense. I think it makes sense to have one slide that just says we looked at extending the sewer system, because that might be a question somebody might be interested in, and it was part of the study. So you can say, yeah, we did look at the need for sewer extensions. And maybe like Mike is saying, that map is pretty good.
Right.
We looked at these areas and it was concluded that based on the things, factors we looked at, there was no need to extend the sewer system,
right.
Something like that.
So if we took out page 7 and kept the slide at the top of page 8,
yeah.
And what's changed on the slide at the top of page 8 was that they didn't have why these were flagged. So I asked them to put in basically poor soils, pump outs. I think that's why they're high priority.
I think it's really helpful.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I think in terms of on-site disposal question, I don't think there's this, I actually think over the span of time, there's less awareness now of trouble spots in the community compared to what there was when the standards were more stringent for having to comply with the requirements that existed years ago, and that many neighborhoods were having to deal with the consequences of poorly designed and installed systems and failing systems. I think that we've gotten over that hurdle. I think it's been dealt with on a case by case basis as each house transfers, and the requirements that I don't look like maybe more stringent or less stringent is the wrong way to characterize it, but it's there's the span of time has, I think, helped address what might have been considered a more significant problem in the community. Not that it isn't important to continue to consider extending sewer lines because it is, it's something that eventually has other added benefits. But I think that that's a good idea. It's another good reason to not dwell on that. Mm-hmm. I think it's not the hot spot in terms of public awareness that some of the other issues might be. And getting back to David's point, I think it was, let us focus on the things in terms of the public presentation that are of the more critical nature. Mm-hmm. I think it adds to the credibility of the presentation by doing that. It doesn't get you off on, well, we need this and we need that and we need everything, but.
Okay, so we're going to take out the slides on page 7, and we're going to keep the only slide of page 8, the top slide,
right,
for the small discussion.
Yes.
Yeah, we don't need, that one.
Which one?
One on 6.
What about, Jim was just mentioning about the one at the bottom of 6.
You know, that's really up to client public. It's an intro.
It's a 30-second screen or 10-second screen.
Right.
10 seconds.
If they want to flip right through it. It does contribute to
clarity,
especially if somebody's viewing it themselves online.
Mm-hmm. I have a similar suggestion for infiltration and inflow.
Mm-hmm.
I think I would keep that slide and the map the bottom of page 10 of the info, because I think that that's one of the key things that we know we have to upgrade equipment at the plant, and we know that in the future we can probably reduce the load on the plant if we take some of the storm out of the system, but we can't afford to take this flow out of the system because it's so expensive and we have to fix the plant, so that's the priority. But I think the public ought to know about this other problem, which is pretty significant in terms of dollars.
And I also think if I were making the presentation, I would want infiltration inflow because it's a great illustration of several concepts.
I made copies and gave it to everybody at our sales meeting
this
week.
Totally.
It is a great way to
help
you understand
and vocabulary.
What's going on. Yeah.
But the other stuff where the engineering behind it, I don't think they need to know that. They just need to know that there's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
This sort of scales the problem graphically.
So if we did that, we kept page 8, first slide. We got rid of page 9, bottom slide, as being too technical in nature.
I would get
both
on page 9.
Okay.
I think I would too.
So it would be a discussion on II and what it means.
Infiltration, inflow, that slide I would keep. And then I'd go right to this because it sort of follows the plan and the other.
Right, so this slide on bottom page 8, bottom slide, with a discussion of what II is,
they
going
just
right to bottom of page 10.
Yes.
Okay.
They could do that verbally. There's a nice graphic.
Well,
and then say, this is the size of the problem. Again, that's just, they add some explanation.
I think the top of 10 is a helpful slide. It helps us focus.
Really?
Top of 10 says we don't have a problem with infiltration and we have a big problem with inflow. And then here is the map that shows you the problem with inflow.
Okay. But they could say that right here. Infiltration and inflow. We can learn that. Infiltration.
They could.
Infiltration, we weren't bad. Inflow is pretty significant, and this is where it is in the city. And that's going to mean tearing up lots of roads, but we don't want to do that now because the plant's falling apart.
Okay. So then on page 11, we had conclusions on it, and we talked about hydraulic. Well, first one was basically a graph chart at the plant of a 2-inch rainstorm that we had in 2013. And it just shows the magnitude of this is kind of flow that comes in the plant in a few hours' time with a heavy rain event.
I think that's a nice graphic. People can see it's off the chart.
Do you want it?
Literally.
I do too. They're going to retain
too.
That. That's going to mean something. But
do you want
an
that,
engineer showing all these numbers. And
do you want that inserted perhaps after the bottom slide on page 8? It's kind of the introduction that this is what we're seeing?
Sure.
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Shouldn't the conclusions come after findings?
Well, we can change the words.
Yeah.
It's not really a conclusion, it's more of an example.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we're on to the next section, which was, so let me just make sure I got this right. We're keeping the slide, bottom slide on page 8 with an introduction. Page 9, both slides disappear.
Right.
Page 10, both slides stay. And page 11, top slide moves to page 8, bottom.
I'm not sure, Ned. At the top of 10, I think that was an argument that said that that all could be presented
yes.
when they looked at the picture and we don't need it.
Right. Info, in fact, if you look at the info, that tells them that's off the charts. You don't have to show them anything about infiltration because we didn't find anything really significant. But the inflow we did, so there's the, it's off the charts and here's where it's happened.
So
I would kill top of 10.
Yep.
And then we talked about reversing the order so that slide 11 top goes ahead of slide 10 bottom. Is that what we talked about?
Is that just part of bottom?
Because that follows, follows inflow, infiltration and inflow. And the guy just said it's infiltration, wasn't all that bad, but inflow, we had some significant findings. Here's an example off the charts. This is where, see, now.
Okay, so bottom slide, page 11, we get into hydraulic capacity assessment.
I kind of feel like, I don't know how important this is. I mean, if you're thinking about shortening up the presentation, there weren't any real conclusions about hydraulic capacity being a problem in the system, right?
Right. Hydraulic capacity under normal flow conditions, no. Under wet weather conditions, we have one sanitary sewer overflow that's chronic down on Barrett Street.
Just seemed like a lot of slides for something
yeah.
that wasn't.
If you look, if you read 13 top, findings from model, a limited number of pipe capacity issues generally related to wet weather flows, which is.
I was going to suggest we keep that. The detail that precedes it.
Two slides
on 12.
Mm. Both sides
on
12.
I don't think those are needed.
So we're keeping bottom slide, page 11 as the introduction, and the last slide of this section on top of page 13.
Yep.
Okay. So the next section is risk approach to project prioritization.
I like that.
I was ready to get rid of this whole discussion.
Okay.
I don't know how everybody else feels about it, but.
I kind of feel the same way. Like, I don't think the public necessarily cares about how an engineer
right.
goes about
right.
calculating.
Oh,
this.
Come on, it's fascinating.
I'm not
to you, maybe.
I agree with you, but, and I'd be sitting there like.
Look at that slide right there.
I saw that delay film.
Yeah.
First of all, it's painfully obvious.
I like the existing conditions. I think you need more photographs of the pumps that are, you know, underwater and the rust and the goop coming out of the walls and the electrical outlets and all that stuff.
Yeah. I had the same comment.
You know, the problem with PowerPoint where you just got a bunch of words and the guy's repeating the words, mm-hmm. give me a good picture.
Risk assessment is an important concept, and the person that's doing the talking should be able to address it as a collateral discussion. But pictures are really the point of the PowerPoint.
Right.
And to have more pictures, we've seen pictures, and there are a lot of pictures in here, so that's really great. But some, even if it's not obvious what's wrong with the equipment, having that picture there.
Dramatic. Yeah. It's a dramatic impression. Yeah. People can say, whoa.
Really? Yeah. Does that make sense to other people too?
It does. I think that if you can get people into some of those pump rooms, they go, this is now, right? This
well,
is my basement, I'd be calling from.
They may not know what they're looking at. You know, they may not know that it's all rusty and could fail, and but that's an opportunity for the person showing the slide to discuss it at that point, and then they'll know what they're looking at. So.
So we get rid of the entire risk approach section at this point, and just going into wastewater treatment plant and expanding on that, it sounds like, too.
Not that the concept isn't important, it's just maybe not important for these meetings.
Yeah, and if you concentrate on the wastewater, the condition of the facility by emphasizing as part of the presentation, then you're gonna have a better chance of having people understand what the support's needed.
All right, so we're at the bottom slide on page 15, existing conditions, wastewater treatment facility. Page 16.
So before we leave this, Ned, this is the only picture that shows that the buildings are in terrible shape. In fact, my comment on some of the other pictures were they were too pretty. Things look nice and clean, and so the speaker either needs to spend some time pointing out for the public that this is one example of our buildings and talk about the condition here, or we need to use this picture someplace else.
And the problem about this picture, if I could add on to what you're saying, is it looks like it's dented, and everybody knows if you have a dented car, not such a big deal, but if there's an oil leak in the car, that's a lot different. So that one good picture telling the story, but if we can get some oil leaks showing, that would be really great.
A worse picture, exactly. I think it's going to be very helpful to have more photographs of whatever it is, just so they understand what is a wastewater treatment plant. They don't know what it is. They've never seen it. I don't even know if they're going to relate to that, but it's a great place to start.
Yeah.
And then you have on the next page. You have a follow-up, you see the up close picture of a tank. I almost feel like someone needs to walk people through. It goes in here, and then it goes here, and this is what happens there, and then this happens here, and then it comes out in something called cake, which I found fascinating. You can have your cake, and you probably don't want to eat it too. Anyway,
so
it's shipped away to who knows where.
There is a slide, we talked about doing an aerial map, like, or an aerial photo and a slide of how it, but the way the process works, it goes all over the place. There'd be circles going everywhere.
Right.
So that's why we stuck with page 16, bottom slide, the process.
Uh-huh.
Just a straight line process of how this thing works. If you put it on the picture of the plant from the aerial view or the photograph, you're going to have arrows, like I said, going back and forth and all over. And
Ned, I think you're absolutely right. So you understand this is the process, and this is the equipment. It's not lined up exactly in straight lines, but there's a lot of equipment. And if you have a failure, one piece fails, then the whole system shuts down. So I think that if they understand that, those two slides will certainly, I think, illustrate that. That's all one system.
Okay, yes. What I was going to say, again, now I'm talking from a consumer standpoint, is that I would love to see those. I love both of those, and I would love to see them side by side in the discussion. Because you're going to be talking about existing conditions, and then you're going to talk about the top of page 18, I think is just the best ever. But you really need to sort of be talking about the bottom of page 16. So it'd be nice to have them side by side, but then from a design standpoint for the presenter, it's hard to do that all on the, I understand that if you collapse it too much, you're not showing anything.
Sure. I was going to say, I love the process diagram, but if I held up this aerial, I could describe what's happening there.
Yeah, you could.
So why don't we do that?
Okay.
Because this is more, like, this is what you get when you're getting a bachelor's degree in wastewater treatment or something. But you can hold up this picture and explain.
We have to have this.
Yeah, I think they could. They wouldn't need to show the arrows and stuff,
no,
but they could say,
primary
clarifier, whatever. I mean, there's a few key processes there that, you know, so people basically understand what happens when it comes in.
If the guy really wants to go slide crazy, you have PowerPoint, you click on different things and slide
That's
overlaps,
right.
And then you click on the next one, and that one closes.
Oh, no,
and that
you
one
can
pops
do
it.
It's
up.
Really easy.
It is really easy to do.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
It's very easy to do.
Yeah.
And this slide sort of stays in the background, and this thing sort of almost like
it's
pops out.
Yeah.
It would only take 15 minutes.
Well, it'd probably take me a couple of hours to do it, because I don't do it often enough. But
no.
But it's really easy.
It is pretty easy to do.
The consultant does have a week to do this.
Oh, it's no problem. Mm-hmm. How many pop slides do you want? Would you like 5 or 10?
I'd rather have it for
so it sounds like the slide at the bottom of 16 is going to disappear.
Yes.
The question is, we started back at the plant and we talked about bottom of page 15, you want better dramatics or dramatic impressions of things that are going on. So we could find probably a better damaged building or something wrong than this picture.
Yeah.
Got it.
Better pictures.
Okay.
I think the pictures need to be taken with something other than maybe a phone to of those areas, so as to bring them into more resolution, a better, clearer resolution, and maybe not make it so hard to distinguish what is the bad part and what is just sloppy maintenance mm-hmm. of the building.
Okay.
Deferred maintenance, I should say.
We're going to keep the slide at the top of 16, which is basically a background of the plant.
Yeah, I think so.
We did expand on that. Actually, a lot of that wasn't even in the old slide there, as far as plant and what happened over the years, plant upgrade history and so on.
Right.
So we'll keep that. Bottom slide 16 will be gone. This NPTEs permit conditions, did anyone have any comments on that? And maybe the bottom of 17 is just too technical?
I think probably the permitting thing is important, just so people know that we're not doing this because we think we ought to do it. That there is a regulatory body that basically demands we do it, and mm-hmm. if we don't, we have to pay money. And so I think it's important that they understand this, that the treatment plant, the condition of the plant is regulated. I don't know how to convey that without getting too burdensome. But
I think what I'd do is remove the slide at the bottom of 17 up above this NPDES permit conditions. A lot of that is about what the new permit will be, so the pending, because we're talking about, so the slide on the bottom, we say we have a permit, we're meeting the current permit conditions with the facility that we have. And then the slide at the top of 17 actually, it says existing conditions there, but a lot of these things, it talks about the future permit outlook and that these are things that may change how we treat the wastewater. So those are elements that have to be worked into the future of the plant. So the first one would be, we have a permit under existing conditions, we're meeting things with the facility that we have, and then this other one should be more about future permit conditions, I think.
Do we have a future section, or all these slides are titled?
No, it says existing conditions there, but it's not really.
Well, maybe it should, rather than say, as the next line is NPTEs permit conditions, maybe it should say future anticipated NPTEs permit
right.
conditions.
Right. So the pending or future. Future.
Yeah. Then we go back to existing.
Well, maybe this slide needs to move to the toward the end.
Yeah, maybe.
And CMON, CMON, what's that?
That makes sense. Does that make sense to you, Jim, to move the, we go through the existing conditions, we see all the things that are in trouble, we need to repair, we need to replace, this is the reason why, and then when we're done, we want to make sure that we've built in some extra capacity for the future, at least allow room for equipment that will allow us to accommodate future permit requirements.
I sort of like keeping all the permit information together.
Yeah.
I think we need to. I think if we try to move this to another spot, it interrupts the message that's being delivered later on.
I think so. It just goes to say that as we're evaluating the existing condition of the facility, we need to be aware of the future needs that may be driven by the permits.
Okay. I think that's right.
So
I move it. Jim's suggestion of putting the bottom slide on 17 at the top.
Yes.
And then flipping the two, I think works.
Would it make sense to just cross out the first two lines and start with future permit outlook,
right.
20-year horizon?
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The fact
that
we applied for our permits is that important.
Yeah, we already said we have a permit.
You'll need to explain CMON in there because the place that's referenced earlier.
Right, we had that slide earlier that told what it was. So.
Yeah.
That may not be as critical here, because that's more about, it's more about the collection system, and now we're talking about the plant. So
you could actually take it out?
You could take it out, and then
see mom run.
Have the nitrogen in there.
And phosphorus.
And I think
it's rain.
Mm-hmm.
A lot.
Is that rain?
We need it.
But I
yeah.
parked my bicycle in the shelter, dry shelter. You got to keep that overhang. It's awesome.
And I think the important thing about the nitrogen limit is that it may require other certain types of new plant processes.
Right.
So maybe we can add a bullet that it would require new processes.
And we might, that's an important concept of
so
the change.
Processes and tankage or something.
Say goodnight.
All right.
Fun talking we do about wastewater
treatment.
Oh, stay dry.
Yes, stay dry. Bee fleet.
Okay.
Night.
Good next meeting.
Yeah.
So we're going to try to pop the slide on top of 18. We're going to try to do some magic and pop outs and a better discussion of flow through the plant and what things do in this.
That'd be great.
We could play John Carver's YouTube video there of his tour of the plant, but that's like 15 minutes long.
Mm. Well, I'd love to see like headworks and grit processing. I mean, people just don't know what happens.
Is there any portion of his video that might be helpful? And using it as an example of What was the purpose of his video?
It was NCP coming in during Public Works Week and doing a thing on the wastewater treatment plant.
So
and basically, it's a, I don't think it's 15, I think it's like probably a 10-minute video that is John walking through the process of the plant, outside, walking around. And
does any of it add any additional emphasis to the condition, the poor condition? No.
It's just basically a walk through the process.
Yeah, so this is how it operates, and this is where it comes in.
And this is where we discharge to the Connecticut River.
Yeah.
But having a, you could have a reference to it, see this YouTube video if you like, or something like that, for additional information.
It's not much longer than Jim Dostal's pump station video. When we did the stormwater utility, all those meetings, we played that video on all the meetings.
I haven't seen it in probably a year, year and a half, to take a look at it again.
Okay.
See if it makes sense to...
Might make sense to do it if it's not too long. I mean, talk about pictures, but you get it.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's very... I haven't seen it, but it's got to be entertaining.
It is.
And nice break
well,
from these slides.
For those who have really limited understanding of it at all, it provides a capsule, I suppose, of what how it really works,
mm-hmm.
which is a better way to help understand other parts of this.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I wonder if you could check that out.
I will. Yeah. I'll check that out.
I think there's probably a way
where
you can edit sections so that as he walks through it, he gets to a certain thing and he's explaining what it is and he's explained it, but then you can emphasize, you can then pop in a still photograph of the equipment up close and the guy can say, well, this was built in 1972 and we've replaced this and fixed that, but it's time to. Concrete's falling apart. I don't know, but you can sort of emphasize the condition piece
yeah.
and then let him lead you on the tour and then stop the film again and have a still picture of some other piece of equipment.
And we've taken a lot out.
Well, I think that's important is to reduce the technical stuff and focus on the conditions
mm-hmm.
things, and there's a lot of stuff that needs to be fixed. And
mm-hmm.
this is, but you want to have enough information where they understand that.
Okay, I'll take a look at that and
yeah.
see how we can possibly fit it in and make it work.
Cool.
bottom slide, page 18, basically the things that they looked at during the assessment, major bullet points. Top of 19 was the condition assessments and how they rated those by condition, performance, safety, and then tried to prioritize it for replacement.
So that's one where I wondered if you needed it, if you could eliminate it.
Okay.
Not the picture.
Picture you can use.
We need the picture, but this whole concept, it's like the risk assessment discussion earlier that we deleted.
Okay. So just get rid of the table, we'll keep the slide?
Yeah, yeah, maybe that's the answer.
And we could drop overall priority, because that's related to the table. And just show, each is set, each, you know, each thing was assessed for condition, performance, and safety.
What I would do is I'd take that picture, I'd probably put it somewhere on page 20, where we start looking at the major findings. Where we talk about equipment, age and equipment.
Or just to blow up the picture, make it even larger on that page and
sure.
And easier for people to
I would
understand.
Could we add one more word, which I think is really important to all of this stuff, and that's reliability? I mean, that's sort of performance, but performance would be, is it meeting its design performance, but is it reliable? Maybe it's meeting its performance when it's working, but when it fails, of course it doesn't. So I think reliability is a lot of what we're talking about here. We want the plant to work reliably. Does that make sense?
Yeah. It makes sense, but they didn't do a reliability tab.
There's no column for reliability.
Oh.
If not,
but to get rid of the table, it's not so
well,
important.
No, but I mean, this is, I'm talking on the slide, the condition assessment rating, each asset rated yeah. for condition, performance, safety, and I would say reliability. I mean, they were they had to be thinking about
yes.
that reliability.
That must fall under performance.
I agree,
or condition,
but it's
so
an
maybe
important word.
It's another word yeah. for overall priority.
Well, the thing may be performing fine, but it doesn't work because there's an electrical problem somewhere else. So that's what.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some of the pumps may be wonderful, but the wires going to the pumps yeah. could be horrible. That's mm-hmm. what I think that
covers a lot.
Condition of the pump may be fine, but it's not reliable because the switchgear over here is, you know, toast, and the generator isn't big enough. And, you know, so that's the reliability side.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's what I mean. Oh, it's all connected. It's a system. It's mm-hmm. not just one thing.
So you want the word reliability added in one of those bullets.
I
and
would.
You want the bottom table out.
Yes.
Okay.
And the picture larger.
And the picture larger.
Otherwise, we love it.
Otherwise, you had it absolutely perfect.
Bottom 19, capacity assessment, means some kind of technical information on the plant itself. I'm not sure if that you want to have a place here or not.
I was okay with it.
Okay.
I think it's probably important for people. It's a scale thing.
Then we have major findings on all the number of bullets here. I assume this is where you want the slew of new pictures coming in also, because we have them starting in major projects on page 25. And maybe not all the pictures would be addressed in the first 5-year CIP, so that's what I'm trying to figure out how you want to separate those. Mm-hmm. What I was trying to do is get to some of the plant major issues and discussion points on page 25 or 26. You know, one of the classic pictures we could show is the wooden trough that was set up by the electrical conduit running water down away from the floor because of the water coming into the bottom of the control room.
It was going down into the sub-basement where there was clearly water flowing out of electrical
conduits.
Devices. Yeah. Anyone would see that as that. This is not good.
It's probably still there.
I think it is.
It is. We're working on that contract as we speak.
Yeah.
Well, so I'm back to page 20, top slide now.
Any photographs of the sub-basement flooded out?
Pardon me?
Do you have any photographs when that basement was completely underwater? I mean, didn't that whole thing fill up?
We have pictures of the water line in the basement, I know that. I'm not sure if we have pictures of the actual water itself, because there's no power down there. And that thing got submerged.
Right. Well, I think it's important for people to know that some serious things go wrong because of inflow, but I mean it's...
The water line's better than nothing.
Well, yeah, the water line works fine. then you can see what's there. It's just water, then you don't see the motors under the water.
You don't know what got flooded.
Yeah.
Right.
I like that. If we can do it, that would be a good one to toss in there.
Next section was alternatives analysis and capital planning. And so there's a slide there of the plan with bullets going to each one as to the work that was recommended to come out of it. Very hard to read, but that's what that's showing. Every one of those tabs and the point is work that we're looking to do under the CIP.
You're talking about the bottom slide on 21?
Top slide
on
21.
Oh, okay. Well, when it's projected, it'll be...
That's a good slide.
Yeah, I agree.
And then we get into some of the recommendations for the wastewater treatment plan of $56 million worth of work over a 20-year plan. The next slide on top of page 22.
Well, by the way, Ned, I think that's probably the amount of detail that that slide deserves. For discussion, as opposed to walking through each line item. I don't think listing each line item is helpful.
Okay.
People.
You mean just have a slide that says 56?
No, show it.
Yeah.
But then say, you know, we've itemized all the, you know, listed all the categories of recommendations, and the total is 56 million without.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you need to see some kind of breakup.
I do
that
too.
That looks like it's a good way to do it.
Yeah.
Okay. So, page 21, we're keeping both slides.
Yeah.
Then we have top of 22, review of major findings, the collection system, which discusses the pump station's inflow and high risk sewers.
We have to keep those, and they're kind of brief, which is good, but they shouldn't, that's sort of, to me, it goes back to the bird's eye view of the city, knowing that there's
Or do you believe that this belongs at the end of the collection system, page 22?
I was confused about the placement of the slide at the top of 22, but I see that we're in this section called analysis and capital plan, and the first thing they had was review of major findings at the plant. Now they have review of major findings in the collection system and the pricing. So there is a
flow
here and a symmetry to it. I guess this is the place to put it, or do both of those come before they start their alternatives analysis? I guess you have to have the analysis before you know what you're doing, so.
I think it makes sense so people can see there's
another
collection
30.
And there's treatment. And
yeah.
And collection, I mean, the biggest problem with collection, I'd say, is that we have too many cross connections. It's really, you know, overburdens the plant, but to spend money on that first, would be nice in the perfect world. We can't afford to wait that long. We have to spend it on a plant, so.
So page 23 is the implementation and steps for implementation, how we're looking at scheduling this work.
I was a little confused on top of page 23, I didn't quite get the old system, big arrow, little arrow. New system, little arrow, big arrow. I'm sure that there's some underlying sense to that.
The guy really liked to play around with arrow sizes.
We could get rid of the arrows and just put it in the lower slide that says implementation steps. And get rid of basically that slide.
No, you're right. But I think it's you start with an old system, You do all this work in the middle.
Yeah.
And then you come out with a new system.
Yeah, I understand that part.
Oh, I didn't.
But I just didn't get the arrows didn't do it for me.
And a big arrow to a little one.
It's not really needed.
Okay.
All right.
Of all the things we wanted to think about, it's not arrows here, but we have probably concentrate on content.
Top slide 23 disappears, and we keep the bottom slide with a big capital bold implementation.
Right. Yep.
Top of 24, prioritizing the capital improvement plan. Basically all the reasons why we're doing it. And then we get into our...
Excuse me, Ned, we've had this list of... This listed, I guess it's a general list. It's very similar to the list at the top of page 20. Not the same list, but...
No, it's not the same list. Because these were all the recommendations versus our
just
5-year
the
schedule.
Plan, yeah.
The first one, which is starting under this spreadsheet.
So these are all the things that were taken into consideration to come up with.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. This works.
And then this is where I was going to have a discussion of some of the major projects that were going to be entailed at the facility, such as the gaseous chlorine disinfection changeover. And I'm not sure if you want to have dollars attached to these projects. Like the chlorine one is $570,000. And we talked about that on last Wednesday. We said we leave the dollar values out of it.
I think it's tough to relate for people to...
We presented costs on the bottom of page 24.
Yeah.
And if we present individual costs, people might try to start adding them up. And
okay.
I would just leave the totals
yeah.
here
mm-hmm.
and just talk about the projects.
Okay.
Without costs.
So we had the gaseous chlorine, the switchgear and generators, a major $2.6 million project all by itself. Aeration tank control valves. We really can't, moving forward, we can't change our process that well because of the way the gates are failing inside the tanks. So we're kind of stuck in the mode that we're in right now. So this was a major project to be done also at the plant. And then the...
By the way, I had trouble figuring out what these pictures were. I mean, there are two pictures here, obviously. The upper one must be a control rod.
It is a control rod that's basically corroded almost all the way through. And the bottom one is additional bracing we had to put on a control rod because it was peeling out of the concrete.
Okay. So those are details that will come out
of
the presentation.
And the rest of it's all underwater. You can't see
right,
it.
Right. Okay.
As long as there's discussion about that.
Mm-hmm. Right, there has to be.
And then we have the dewater sludge conveyance system, which is basically obsolete at this point. I'll have a discussion on that also. And the only one I thought about saying was going to add was we recently had an issue with our return activated sludge pumps.
Mm-hmm.
One went down, so we asked someone to come in and look at it and repair it. And while he was doing that and had it out torn apart, the second pump went. So we're down to two pumps now instead of four pumps. So we got an emergency contract or permission through the state, and we're repairing those two. But these are original plants from 1979, these pumps. So I was going to maybe add that one as another
sure.
recent story that. If we're down to one pump, we're not pumping.
Well, that's exactly the reliability and performance. They're performing fine until they don't, so they're not reliable. They may be performing just fine. You're doing maintenance and one of them quits. Right, so for 4 years they're performing fine, but are they reliable? That's why I think adding that word reliable on the 10 slides back is important.
We took the whole section on risk assessment. We can put that back.
Forget that. Reliability. Forget about risk. We just want reliability.
And then we get into different funding options. This will also be in the executive summary of these. These are all the kinds of things that we look at, how we might be able to pay for the project. And then we have this summary of that came out of the 20-year plan, which is $87 million, that ought to make their ears perk up a little bit.
Yeah, that was the combined plant and
that's everything.
System, yeah.
Yep. But our focus really is immediately is the 5-year CIP.
Right.
And then there's acknowledgments, some questions, and then the last two slides are just information in case someone asks, well, what's Project P1 mean and P2 and P3? There's just some bullets there of the work that was going to be done. And that was more for my reference in case someone asked.
Good. Okay. Any other comments on this?
No, I've got all in mind.
Great. Well, thank you, Ned, very much.
Yeah, I will try to have something to you for this weekend, if possible. Okay?
Okay.
When is the presentation scheduled?
Wednesday night, 5:30 at the Senior Center. I think they call it the Great Hall, the big room.
So that's the 16th?
Yeah.
Yeah, and then the second one will be the 30th at 6:30 at JFK Community Room.
I just wanted to give you a very brief quotation from a client, one of the clients of the books. Overall, the Northampton Water Treatment Plant is well maintained and functional. And you know, I'm saying there's another side of the everything's falling apart.
Yeah. I think I said at a previous meeting, we meet permit. You know, we do a great job. We scramble to fix, the staff scrambles to fix things and they meet permit but our message is it's still falling apart and we need to fix it.
And that isn't said in the executive summary, which I finished reviewing today, which you'll also be seeing. This is considered to be potentially handout for the presentations. So that people can take it home and study it and read through it too. It's kind of an overall summary of what we've done. So you don't
that
have
might be a great quote to have in the executive summary. David's quote.
Mm-hmm.
Book six.
Yes. Yep.
So and I thought speaking of what to emphasize, I thought that the presentation that we had here, it was for the uninformed, which I consider myself to a certain extent about this whole matter. I think the there was not enough emphasis on the need. There was too much discussion about what we have and what is in compliance, rather than emphasis on the need, I felt, to replace what is antiquated and not functioning properly. So, as a general part of the suggestion to those making the presentation, it would seem to me that while there is data that has been collected by them to make us feel comfortable that much of what we have is functioning properly, what we need to do is alert the public in an obvious way of the need to be ready to spend $56 million over 20 years in line. And I just think it has to kind of, more attention has to be given to
things that are wrong.
Yeah.
There's one thing that doesn't really come out in this is that the degree of certainty of the need and the cost for the projects that are out 10 or 15, 20 years, the further you go out, the less certain it is that that's the exact project you're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
So we've talked a lot about this internally, that the 5-year CIP, these are things that we know need to be done now. So they're well defined and they're well understood and we know that we need to do them. As you go out 10, 15, 20 years, you know, some of these really projects are showing up as really expensive projects in here. We don't know for sure if those are going to be exactly the projects. I mean, some of them are based on assumptions for nitrogen removal or other elements that are a little bit gray right now. So it might be kind of nuanced for the whole discussion, but I think it's important because the number, you know, 80 million or whatever it is, it's really the 30 million or whatever that's the 5-year CIP that, in my mind, is definitely, that's the number we're talking about today. And then in 5 years, we'll talk about the next 5 years, and then in 5 years, we'll talk about the next 5 years. So the numbers and the projects will be sort of in a state of evolution and evaluation as we continue to go on. So I don't know if that convolutes the story or what, but to me, when I look at it, it's like, I know that 86 million is not, it's not the number. We may decide not to do all those projects as well. I mean, there's a big King Street separator project and some other things. You know, I don't know if they'll be, if it'll be affordable. That's, you know, where things Ned's working out with the mayor relative to the, how do we pay for all this? So, and maybe it's just too nuanced, but I want to
take. Well, I think it's important that the public understand that we're not done at the end of 30 million. Yeah. So if there's a big number after 30 million, we're not going to spend much time discussing it. But you've made it clear to us, at least, that the only thing that's accurately scoped is the first phase.
Right. And part of it, well, we could really, I could go on forever about this stuff, unfortunately, for some that don't want to listen to me. But, you know, there's the whole element of affordability, the things that we definitely need to do. And then some of the things that, if they're not regulatory driven, I keep getting back to the King Street project that they scoped, which was, you know, 10, 15 million or whatever it was. You know, not driven by regulatory action. It's, you know, something that would be good to do, but, you know, we're not going to be jumping up and down to do a project of that magnitude without some significant reason why, because it's so expensive. So it's just a lot of things to consider as time goes on.
Okay. Anything else on this topic? Well, our 15 minutes is up on that, so we will move on. Next item under old business is the water restriction, which is back on.
Yes, yeah, that's me. I asked for that.
Yeah, Pat asked this to be an agenda item.
Yeah, so I don't know.
I think Pat can explain from what I've read is that he's concerned about the credibility of these water bans coming on and off, on and off, on and off, and we're doing what we've been instructed to do. If it's not required, take it off. If it's required, put it on. But I want to make sure that everyone here understands it's part of our water management permit that we have from the state. And the only way it's going to change is that, number one is, let me take a step back. There's the per capita item, or per capita gallons per day being used by individuals. And if we're under 65 gallons per day, there's a certain structure that we have to meet for our restrictions. If it's above 65, it's another set of restrictions. So because we're below 65, we get to do, I think, a lesser restriction than would normally be asked for us to do. And it's part of our permit, so the only way we can do it is the next permit that comes out, we probably have to fight it, protest it. I mean, I understand that the Mill River is a mid-stress basin, and that's what it's based on, but all our water is coming from a basin transfer. So the Mill River is not an accurate gauge for our public water supply, but yeah, it's in our permit.
I understand. And just for the history of it, and then I'm actually really never going to bring this up again because I know it's frustrating
we love
everybody.
It. We love it.
So when that permit was originally obtained, did the city raise objections as to using the Mill River as the basis for determining rather than our own supply?
I believe there was back a number of years ago conversations with the state about that, with the water supply, because they recognize it, but this is because you're the Mill River Basin, Northampton's in there.
A lot of these things that come out, these water management permits, they're really, the state doesn't really, they don't listen to you a whole lot about the concerns. I think when the permit came out, we did some historical research on using the stream gauge to see, you know, what would the impact be in terms of needing to put a restriction on, and we saw that you'd need one every year, and then if you called it on and off, that you could, during the course of the year, like this year, we've had water restrictions, and then we've had to call them off and then put them back on. And, you know, I've said that I think it's, you know, and this is your point, that it's hard for people to understand, it's hard to monitor.
Have we ever fined anybody for it?
Not that I'm aware of.
No.
So how could you? As far as the public is concerned, they would have to be paying close attention to be as aware of the status of the water restriction.
It's really hard to deliver a consistent, you know, it's not delivering a consistent message. You know, there's one other element in the Water Management Act permit is you can just do a calendar-based water restriction.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We have that option, so rather than looking at the stream gauge, we can say from whenever it is, May 15th through September 30th, or whatever the dates are, water restriction is in place. And towns do that. I mean, I've driven through towns in Eastern Mass where it's just, as soon as you cross the town line, it's like water restriction in effect from May through September. It has a right, and there's signs all over the place, but, you know, that may not be the way to go, but it does help you deliver a consistent message.
All right. That's the consistent message that you've given me, so I understand it. It's just that it seems as though, should the opportunity present itself again, I think it would be worth engaging them in maybe a more in-depth discussion about how the determination is made as to put it in place versus.
I mean, I'm willing to make a call to them again. I mean, I probably haven't talked to them about it in a few years specifically, but. I mean, I'm happy to pick up the phone and call them and just have a discussion. Ned sends all the notices. They know what's happening in Northampton.
If you make the call, I'd be interested in knowing if other communities in Western Mass have similar provisions in their permits.
I think a lot of them are tied to stream flow, but it's, you know, the hydrology is different in all communities, mm-hmm. and how you choose to monitor it. And a lot of the water use policy across the state, there's a lot of concern about low stream flows, as you know, Mike. So a lot of the Water Management Act, the state has been sort of grappling with policy that ties water withdrawal to stream flow elevation, and in some cases it's more appropriate than others, and here it's not particularly appropriate because I think the Mill River is so flashy that. You know, and it's also not a true reflection of what our water condition is.
Yeah. Okay. Done.
Next item on the agenda. Under informational reuse committee. On our agenda the last time, and
yeah,
we tabled it.
Yeah. So I just wanted to tell you a little bit about the process of. The reuse center seems to be going well in terms of people coming in, leaving stuff, people picking up stuff and leaving. We don't have the lines painted yet, or at least I was down Saturday, but I
request has been made.
Yeah, I know, and I'm just finding that. And I guess I want, we still have money in the budget. Went forward for this year, right?
We encumbered the funds from last year, the $10,000 that we had. Well,
I think
there
was
like
$7,000. $7,000 stayed in my mind. So that's still there. And what's not clear in my mind, I almost think like it is, like it, but it's what's a question in my mind, and I don't know if anybody had comments on it, is what the value is to our community. When we had a landfill, there was a purpose to it. Right now, it's a strong purpose in the sense that we're giving there's a lot of community support, I would say, and the community is responding, and there's a lot of people that are very happy to be able to leave stuff behind, a lot of people that are very happy to pick stuff up. But I'm just putting it out there about I want people to think about how important it is to our overall agenda it's really up to
as
you.
As a part of the DPW.
As a part of the DPW. And there's a lot of, since we don't have a landfill, that's something we need to consider. And then I wondered if anybody had any questions.
Okay.
we haven't figured out a way to evaluate how well we're doing, but what I can tell you is that it seems like a lot of things come in and go out within an hour. And so like chairs and stuff that people use.
So I've used it a little, mm-hmm. and I find, and I probably was a little skeptical at the beginning. Mm-hmm. I thought there were other outlets for most of these materials, but mm-hmm. I find that it's a real convenience.
Okay.
Because it I do think you take some items that you probably couldn't take somewhere else, some building materials that
mm-hmm.
there's certainly not a local outlet for. And then the practice of taking an item that might just be trash and you get the donor to pay for the disposal
mm-hmm.
means that there's some materials that might not mm-hmm. make it in the waste stream because of that,
mm-hmm.
that you just wouldn't want to drop off at a thrift shop mm-hmm. because what would they do with it? So, I don't know, it seemed to me to be quite a convenience.
Okay, I'm just wanting to make sure that
the employee is
behind
this.
Well,
it's just my experience.
No. I mean, it is true that there are some things that can go to other places in the community, but there is a real community feeling, I think, out there. I mean, there's a lot of people that come in, they know each other. That's a positive aspect of that. So, opportunity for questions or comments. Thank you. And I will say one more thing that, like, what's the name of the building group in Springfield? Eco Building Supply, yeah. So like they will come up on Wednesdays and pick stuff up. Salvation Army will come and pick stuff up. So we are acting as there's a lot of volunteer hours that go into this, and then people pick up stuff and take it home. So instead of people in Northampton having to take it all away to Springfield, they're there. So there's some positive aspects mm-hmm. of that.
And that's efficient.
It is efficient.
Very efficient.
So, just keeping everybody apprised of the situation. Do you have any other thoughts?
No, I think it's going quite well.
Okay.
The surprising thing maybe is the achievement of a balance between what comes in and what goes out.
Mm-hmm.
Because there isn't a lot of space to accumulate.
No. Right.
Anything else on this item? Okay. Next is contract update.
You have the list in front of you, contract updates. First one is a Chapter 90 project, which is looking at King Street corridor. It includes North and Summer Street intersections and Finn and State and King Street intersections. It's already in the Transportation Improvement Program for funding, I believe, in FY18. So we're moving along with the design and all the work behind it.
What are the limits on King Street again?
Basically south of Dunkin' Donuts up to Finn Street, but also including Finn and State Street also.
Okay.
That intersection met the warrants for a signalized intersection a number of years ago. And so we're trying to figure out what to do with that section between State and King Street. That seems to be a critical mass of vehicles going there and clogging up. So it's a short corridor project that we're looking at. Next one is Pulaski Park construction, which I believe you are all aware of. Underway starting what day, Jim?
September 28th.
Starting the 28th. And that was done through community preservation funds. The next project has been a project Jim's been working, dedicated himself to, Trinity Road Park fountain construction. And that money was all public donations toward the project. And I think it will be a very similar fountain to what you're seeing in the center of Florence. It's going to look nice.
It's going to do this fall?
End of October?
End of October.
Yeah, we're hoping to get it in this fall.
Next one is a change order for a very large thrust block on a 24-inch diameter water main that was installed. That's the $5,660. Next one is a little project we're doing with Tate and Howard. Currently, our sludge disposal from the lagoons at the water treatment plant are going to the landfill for about $25 a ton. We're looking to see if we can do a land application somewhere on it, where we might be able to save money and be not dedicated to bring it to a landfill either going forward. The next project is a change order with Warner Brothers, who's our current pavement contractor. This is to include Winslow Avenue for paving and also provide shoulder support on Chesterfield and Reservoir Roads. When they came in and did the cold in place recycling, the pavement swelled a little bit, and then with the new overlay, we have edges exposed that don't have a transition to the ground. And those are the first sections that are going to break off with larger trucks. So this is putting basically a 2-foot shoulder backing up to the edge of the pavement so it doesn't get ruined in a short time.
What is it? What is the used material?
It's a gravel material.
TRG or something?
It wouldn't be TRG, no. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. I could go look, but it's just a material. They're putting down and compacting it in place. And the last one is our annual pavement condition survey with VHB. This is where they go out and survey 25% of the roads and update our database for future pavement management. They look at the cracks, the distresses, and so on, and come up with a plan for us. So that's what we had since the last meeting.
Questions?
Yes, so the pavement condition survey, that 25% road survey, would that influence next year's paving plan?
It will.
And so it rolls over. This isn't some future thing. This is basically going to be applied to an immediate.
Yeah, right now our goal is to have this database back to us by December 1, so we can create the plan probably in January, late January, for the upcoming year.
Any other questions on contracts? Move on to Pulaski Park update, which I understand will start on September 28th.
That is true. We had a pre-construction meeting with Mountain View contractors today to review the project, and they're looking at starting on September 28th. They're going to go through as long as they can this fall, getting a lot of work done, and then picking up the project in the spring. They're anticipating that they'll be done in May or June of next year, so got a lot of demolition work to be done, a lot of site preparation type work to be done. Some hardscape improvements along Main Street where we have this Pulaski Plaza, if you remember the proposal for the park. They're going to try to wrap up that element this fall. So looks good. They're getting ready to get started. Mm-hmm. We're anxious to get it moving. The mayor's office has been working diligently to get a webcam established so that you'll be able to view the construction from the comfort of your home without getting dusty or hot or cold, as the case may be.
Is there going to be an 800 number so you can call them up and say, hey, the guy over there on the left, he hasn't moved in 3 hours. Bring him a coffee.
Yes, we did tell the contractor today.
Wear your hard hat.
I'm happy to hear that.
Comb their hair. Yeah. Put their hard hat on. But I guess the only other thing is on the overlook for the phase two of the project, we had submitted a park grant a couple of months ago to the state for state funding, and then we hand-delivered a CPA grant application to the Office of Planning today for the fall round. We'll be considered the local match for that project.
Any questions?
Is that Mountain View Landscaping? Is that who's doing it?
Yeah.
Mountain View.
Next on the agenda is paving update.
Yep, that's me. So we had this memorandum put out on April 1st, what we were looking at doing this year. All the crack sealing work has been done. We expended a little over $150,000 on that work this year. So it's probably the largest contract we've had to date in crack sealing. According to Dave Levin, talking with him about a good half of the roadways are done at this point. We're still hoping that will be substantially complete by mid-October, but as you can see, Prospect Street has been done at this point with new bike lanes also.
Very nice.
When we did this section of North Elm Street, we were able to actually take bike lanes from the high school and bring them up and tie them into this intersection. So as you're doing traffic projects, we're trying to do traffic calming and look at different modes of transportation also with it too. So it's coming along fine. We've had to change some streets that we were going to do due to the finances were a little overdone, so we dropped Hamden Street off, which is a small street off of South Street. So some of the projects have changed a little bit, but the major projects are still moving forward. The coal placement recycling overlay had been done on Chesterfield and Reservoir Roads. We'll find out in a matter of years how well they fare, but I think it was a well thought out project. I think it will work fine. And then we had some rubberized chip seal we did on three different streets, and that work's been done at this point.
Well, the work that's been done is good.
Yeah.
It is good.
Huge improvement.
Yeah.
And the fact that, you know, we're going into the capital plans are due with the city on October 5th. And that's one thing we'll be looking at, is this continuation of the city putting $500,000 a year into our paving program. And hopefully Governor Baker will release the full transportation bond bill and give us $1.5 million instead of $1 million. That would help us a lot.
Looked to me the other day like all our crack sealing budget went on South Street.
Oh boy.
There are hardly spaces between the cracks.
Yeah.
That street is ending its useful life.
Good thing. Anything else on paving?
That's it.
And Third Street Cemetery Preservation Committee?
Just a brief update on this. We had our first meeting with the committee. Rose, a member of that committee. We had a jolly good discussion about the scope of work that was led by Martha Lyon, who's the landscape architect that's helping us with the preservation plan. The next meeting of the committee will be here on October 19th, and we're planning a sort of a public informational session on October 29th at the Senior Center. So that'll be from 7 p.m. to 8:30. So we're looking at trying to get people to come out and provide some input on sort of in a design charrette fashion that Stimson did for Pulaski Park, where we have people set up at round tables and we ask them questions and come up with their own thoughts and plans for what they think improvements to the cemetery might look like in their opinion, and then those ideas will be sort of offered to the group and then compiled together, and then Martha will consider those as she works on the plan. So those are sort of the next, I guess the next big step on that.
What is the date for that, 7 to 9 at the Senior Center?
Yeah, October 29th, it's a Thursday night.
Questions for Jim? Next is watershed land acquisition.
So in your package you have in front of you, you have a double-sided map and a location reference of two parcels of land that we've been asked to purchase from two sisters who own the properties. On the survey plan you can see it's parcel B and parcel C. That we're looking at, it's a total of about 8.5 acres, 8 1/3 acres or so. And on the full color map, you can see where these parcels sit in relation to the watershed. So they're definitely located in the watershed of Mountain Street Reservoir. The land appraisals came out at $77,000 each. The timber values for one parcel was 14.4, the other one was 13.4. So they're basically in the 90-plus range. We offered to buy the parcels originally for 77 each, and the property owners came back and said they had a counteroffer of 90,000 for each parcel. There is a developer who wishes to buy them. The sisters would rather keep them with the city. So that's why they came back with a smaller counteroffer than what the developer was asking. So we have a chance to get a drinking water supply grant for 50% of the cost of the acquisition of these two parcels. We won't know that until next year, but we're going to be applying for it. Those are due at the end of September. And I guess I'm looking for whether you think that you advise us for me to recommend to the mayor that we purchase the land.
Would you purchase it in advance of the grants?
If we purchase it in advance of the grants, we won't get reimbursed, but we have until June. June next year to purchase it.
Oh, okay.
So we should have plenty of time.
Yeah.
Grants, I believe, are usually awarded in February.
They'll know.
We do have money in the OOM account for this. We have a balance of about $250,000. So it's in our budget. Even if we don't get a grant, it's still within our budget.
I think it's a good idea.
Just for reference to the graphic, is this the water treatment plant?
Yes.
Do you need a motion from us, Ned, or just a general consensus?
General consensus would be great. Right.
So we generally...
Consent.
Consent.
I consent.
Excellent.
Great, thank you.
All those who consent, say aye.
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 Nice. You're formally consented. That's it for the agenda. Gary, do you have anything else?
I did ride my bicycle to this meeting for the first time coming up on the new bike lanes, which I think look great. And that was such a huge amount of pavement there. It's nice to see it divided up a little bit better. Preserve the parking. And I'm fine riding on the traffic side of parked cars. I don't have a problem with that. Some people want to do it the other way.
Oh, put it on the inside?
Yeah, I know. It's really crazy. I don't know how to do that. Anyway, I think it looks fabulous, and of course, all the paving is wonderful. And thank you.
Pat?
Just a quick question. Is there any update on Jim Dostal's residential sewer inspections effort? Is there, I got a copy and saw the city solicitor's that the city solicitor weighed in, and I'm just curious if there's a, if it is, has it been proposed as an ordinance? Is it just a concept still, or?
I actually haven't been involved in it at all.
No.
I'm like so far out, I had to beg Ned for a copy of the thing to find out what the heck was going on.
Okay, well then, I'm just kind of keep us in the loop.
I haven't heard anything about that, but yeah, it's proposed, I think it's being discussed, it's a matter of how it's going to be implemented and who will do what and the fees and so on.
Yeah, okay, well that's fine. We obviously, significant impact.
It does have a lot of resources of the Department of Public Works. If all of a sudden you have 5 or 10 inspections in a day and that's our crew that's doing something else.
Right.
As
and the timing of it in relation to the once notified, once the homeowner's notified and the time that they have to comply, not only just that adds to the concerns. But I mean, I'm not opposed to the concept. I think everyone has to have their eyes wide open as to what might be involved in something such as that. It's significant in terms of staff time, but it's also going to affect a lot of people in a lot of different ways that they'll be completely surprised by.
It's all one of those big unknowns when you buy a house in the city.
Yeah, and the timing of it in relation to that acquisition of a house and the time of the year in which work would need to be done to correct whatever violations might be noted is another issue as well. So I'm just curious. I hadn't heard anything about it, and it was part of an email that was circulated from the mayor's office because Jimmy had asked me to be at the meeting that he had set up, and I was unavailable at the time. Thanks.
Ned, anything else?
Yes. Tomorrow, two of our water department employees are going to the state finals of the vehicle safety and snow event down in Boxborough, Mass. Dana Dion and Matt Wintle won the Western Mass first place. And if they win tomorrow at the state, they'll be going to an expense-paid trip to Colorado next year for the finals. So they're leaving here early. The competition starts at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning.
Neat. Jim?
Can't top that.
No. BJ?
I'm good.
David?
All set.
Ro?
Roads are great.
Yeah.
Can we take a minute and talk about our next meeting? Schedule for it. We have two more meetings this month in the form of the presentations.
Mm-hmm.
So perhaps we don't meet in this format until the first Wednesday in October, October 14th. Does that make sense?
Sure. October 7th.
14th.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Yes. Motion to adjourn.
14th. So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
We adjourn.
Thanks.